So we've been, we started off giving the big picture about Agile and Waterfall and where that all came from. And then we've been on this detour where we kind of learned about the software as a service, Agile, all the architecture, all the views, and now learning about Ruby and Rails running. So now we're coming back to the Agile development. In particular, we're talking about behavior-driven design and user stories and things like that. This is the outline of what we'll get through. We'll get through a few of these bullets today, but this maps onto the chapter as the sections show. Let's start off with behavior-driven design, BDD, also known as behavior-driven development, and we'll talk about user stories. So why did this get created? Because projects were failing. It was a sad commentary. I heard this line about software that if we built all the buildings like we built software, the first woodpecker would destroy civilization. So there have been a lot of disappointments about software. So why? Well, one reason is it just doesn't do what the customers want. As we'll see, that has to do sometimes because once the customers see what you've built, they realize that's not what I want, even though it sounded like it. Or they're late. We're going to talk about that, how you estimate time to get things done. You run out of time and money, and so that's another reason to fail. Or, over budget, run out of money. Or you get it working, the first one's okay, but it's really hard to maintain and evolve, and people expect software today to be maintainable. Or you get them all wrong, right? So that's what inspired this kind of manifesto for the Agile Manifesto, and let's just remind you what that is. Since there's be this gap between what they thought customers wanted and what they really wanted, the solution was to work continuously with customer, not like sign a contract, come back in 2 years and show them your result. Let's engage the customer continuously. Not only the customer, but all the stakeholders. So the word stakeholder, the users, the end users of the system, the customers who are acquiring it, the people developing the code, maintenance, if there's separate people operating it, the management, everybody involved. Let's be involved continuously so we're all on the same page. And the way to make sure you understand what's being done is that you're going to maintain a working prototype. So the Rails and Ruby environment lets you have something that's partially operational, but it works, and then you limit your new features to every iteration, which is typically a week or two. In this class, we'll do it every week so you can get lots of iterations in. Now, this is in contrast to that waterfall model where there are these major phases, right? You would do the design and that would last for 4 months, and then you'd start, or you'd do the specs and then the design and then the development, and later would be testing. And so that basically, Agile Manifesto was a rebellion against the conventional wisdom of these major phases. Each takes a month long and hundreds of programmers and extensive documentation. Let's instead work with the customer continuously, and we check and make sure what you do next. A lot of the problem the programmers have is they'd anticipate what the customers would want or what the other stakeholders would want rather than just asking them. So every week or so, let's just make sure we're still on the same page and just make sure we're going to build the right thing, not just build what they told us to. So BDD, as it's called, is asking questions before and during development, and the phrase BDD came around after Shoaib talked about test-driven development, is that there was some confusion in test-driven development about what you're supposed to be talking to the customer, and it became useful to use the word behavior-driven design to try and separate it from the implementation. So that's what we'll talk about test-driven design, or Monica will talk about that next week. We're going to finish talking about behavior-driven design, but the idea you're trying to capture the behavior you want as opposed to how you're implementing it, and that's why the names came along. The mechanism is written down as user stories, and we'll talk about how that came from, which is supposed to be kind of an easy, understandable way to talk to regular people, non-technical people, so that you can communicate with them to reduce the chances of misunderstanding. And again, it's the B part is behavior versus the implementation. TDD really is about implementation and this the unit testing versus the higher level acceptance testing. All right, what are these user stories we've been talking about? It's typically one to three sentences that fit an everyday language. The idea was to put them on a 3x5 card. We've had practice in this class with 3x5 cards, so you know what they look like. And it's written with the customer or by the customer. So here's an example of a user story. This format of is the stylized format, which has as a and then kind of stakeholder so that I can achieve some goal I want to, came from a startup company called Connextra, and they gave this stylized version, which is useful for people to follow. So the format here is that there's a feature name that's right there at the top of the card with, let's add a movie. And then here is the story that, as a movie fan, so that I can share a movie with other fans, I want to add a movie to Rotten Potatoes database. This is just what we've been doing. Now, these three phrases, to follow Connextra format, they have to be there, but they can be in any order. They don't have to be in this order. And the idea here is that these user stories, because they're written before you've built any code, they can be used as acceptance tests. So why the 3x5 cards? This actually came from our colleagues in the human-computer interface community. They were dealing with trying to get people to have good user interface designs, and so rather than doing it in code, they came with these 3x5 cards. The idea is that it's non-threatening. If you're working on these cards, it's kind of, you're playing with it, and everybody kind of participate. And rather than just the programmers explaining what they thought the user interface should be, it's everybody participate and decide what they like. So the cards, you can throw them away, you can shuffle them, you can prioritize them, so that it was seen to be an inviting way for non-technical people to get involved. In contrast, would be to do some kind of wireframe program. You actually have kind of a user interface working, and people would find the customer customers be afraid to make suggestions because it felt to be working. So it was the easier to use technology, made it more attractive for people to participate in it. And since these things are short, it's really pretty easy to change during the development process. Now, it's important that it said as a stakeholder. Why do you do that? Because different stakeholders will have different perspectives about what they want from a particular feature. So I'd like to see which of my friends are going to the show as a theater goer so that I can have more fun with my friends. And I want to see which of my Facebook friends are actually going to the show. Now, that's the perspective of somebody, a user, going to it from the box office manager. Your perspective of why this is a great feature is so that get the patrons to come and get her to bring more of her friends to the show. So the perspective will give different priorities. So maybe, and there needs to be people advocating each of the stakeholders in these descriptions of the user stories. Real systems don't have just a couple of stories. They have hundreds of stories. It's easy to come up with features for a new application to come up all the time. And so what they call is a backlog is this collection of user stories that haven't been implemented yet. And when we talk about, later in the course, when we talk about some of the tools that track user stories, we'll see the word backward again. And so you get these 3x5 cards, and simply what you do is you prioritize them, depending the stakeholders agree. So the most valuable ones are towards the front of the backlog, and the less are behind them. And then if you're going to do specific software releases in coordination with the customer, they want to have something by certain dates, then you use the 3x5 cards and associate the release dates with collections of them.